So yes, you're looking
you
at the camera.
You want me to pull my glasses or something, maybe better? Or?
No, whatever you want to look like.
Okay. All right. Okay, let me get rid of this bag. Okay. Okay, so you can ask me some questions when it gets to 10 minutes and you can let it go, okay? Okay, great.
Sure, so...
just make sure you speak loud, you know.
Yes. So we have with us Angelo'S, and we are debating and...
Hey, how you doing, Philip?
Good. How about yourself?
Hi, guys out there on TV land.
So, what would you like to tell us about this issue, Angelo'S?
Well, I think the issue is a very important issue because whatever is not found in the Word of God, if we make a doctrine out of something that's not found in Scripture, then we have to discard the teaching. I would like to give you an example that we. We always accuse the Catholics of having traditions of men, Matthew chapter 15, but we are doing the same thing when we're creating a King James only controversy, and we're not giving the freedom to Christians to choose the Bible that they understand the best.
Okay. So why is it that you feel that way, Angelo'S?
Well, because nowhere in the Bible does it say that either the prophets in the Old Testament, the Tanakh, or Jesus, our beloved Lord, Savior, Master, and King, or the apostles, which he chose to go throughout all the world and preach the doctrines that he taught them, not only in the 3 years of his ministry, but also in the 40 days after the resurrection.
Okay. I got it.
Let me
okay.
Just get that for there.
I got it.
Yeah. Nowhere does it say in the Bible that Jesus said not to use any translation because he used the Greek Septuagint and the apostles used the Greek Septuagint more than 300 times. So if they use other translations, then that gives us the right to use other translations of the Bible.
You brought up the Greek Septuagint, or what they call the Greek translation of the Old Testament.
The Jewish scriptures, yeah.
What kind of proof can you give us about that?
Well, you see it on page 74. I think it's on page 74 of the Sir Lancelot copy of the Jewish scriptures. You see, when you go to the Sir Lancelot Septuagint. And the word Septuagint comes from the Latin, which means 70, because there were 72 Jewish scholars who worked on the Jewish scriptures to translate them into Greek. And somebody might say to me, "Well, Angelo, there's only the permission was only given to the Levi people to translate or to copy the scriptures." But I say, desperate times calls for desperate measures, because David ate the showbread, and he wasn't supposed to eat the showbread. And he ate the showbread. And the thing is that Jesus said because he was hungry, he was allowed to do so. And in chapter 2 of Mark. And the evidence is that in chapter 40 of Isaiah, you see many quotations that are found in the New Testament that come from the Septuagint, word for word. You see that there. You have like about five passages just on that Sir Lancelot page of the Greek New Testament, meaning of the Septuagint. Use the Greek Septuagint, and it gives us permission to use it.
And how is it that you got interested in this issue, Angelo'S?
Well, I got into this issue because I was debating Brother Greg. He used to come over here, and Brother Greg told me that he doesn't agree with different translations that are not the same as the King James. And so, since I believe that we have to walk by our commander-in-chief, Jesus Christ, he's the one who commands us to either do something or not to do something. And if specifically it doesn't say in the Bible that we're not to use any other translation of the Bible, and that we only have to use the King James, I got very interested, because there's a lot of people who are stumbling, and there's a lot of churches that are breaking up, a lot of friendships are breaking up, probably a lot of marriages broke up because of this issue. And so that's why I really hold fast to the fact that the King James only camp, I understand why they're doing it, but there's not sufficient proof in the Bible that gives them the permission to teach these doctrines. And just one more thing, that Gail Ripplinger really didn't have the scholarship to write such a book, you know, in 1993 when she wrote the book.
And so what happened with this Brother Greg?
Well, Brother Greg, I mean, he because of this issue, we broke off speaking. I mean, he was very angry the last time. And so I recalled him. And the first thing he spoke about was the King James controversy, and then everything went south because of that. So I tried, but people at the camp sometimes are very passionate, and so that's what really happened about this. I do have some debates with him, but sometimes the illogical nature of the camp doesn't allow for friendship to blossom sometimes. And that's just a sad thing. That's why I got involved in it, because I see that it's breaking up churches and friendships and even marriages and all this stuff. I mean, it's really sad for the church.
Okay. So what else would you like to tell us about this issue? We've got about another 3.5 more minutes.
Yeah, no, I like to say that the same things that the King James translators, the same things that the NIV committee or the NASB committee are accused of, I see the King James doing the same thing. For example, in Acts chapter 4, verse 25, you have that God spoke to David, but then you don't see that God spoke to him by the Holy Spirit. Now, you see that in the NIV and NASB, so where's the Holy Spirit? See, we are accused of taking or deleting or extracting out certain things of the Bible, but when the King James does it, then it's like, well, we're not going to pay attention to that, but when the NIV and NASB does it, well, oh, we're gonna grab them on that issue, you know what I mean? But so I see that's a problem. And also in chapter 8 of Romans, verse 34, I see that Jesus is missing there. It says Christ in the King James, and it says Jesus Christ in the NIV and NASB. So I see that he's missing from there. Also, the Spirit of Jesus, that's missing, meaning Jesus is missing from Acts chapter 16, verse 7. That's Jesus, the name Jesus is missing from the KJV, chapter 16, verse 7. But the NIV and NASB have Jesus. So the same thing, meaning the argument, and I know I don't have that much time, but the argument that the camp has against the newer versions, the same thing could be said about the King James Version of the Bible. They were good translators, but that they were not infallible. You just don't see any evidence in the Bible that they were infallible. Because if you say that they were infallible, well, then you cannot accuse the Catholic Church, which is right there to my right, of infallibility, because you're doing the same thing. You know, instead of putting the Pope on ex cathedra on the chair, you're having the King James as an idol. And we're taught not to have any idols in our lives.
So you believe that people are putting the King James Bible above God then, or what?
Yes, I think so. Well, not, I don't think, well, you say people, not all people, but I think that since it doesn't say specifically in the Bible to downgrade people who use the King James, or to downgrade the NIV or the, if Jesus did not say it, and by their fruits you shall know them, said Jesus, another voice that shall not hear, you know, in chapter 10 of John. So we hear other voices saying, like, you know, Ripplicker's telling us what to do, and we follow her or her teaching, or both, then we have to really make our calling on election sure, to make sure that we are in the truth and that our foundation is Jesus and not any tradition that doesn't hold fast to the Bible teaching. And I asked you if that was in the Bible, if it prohibits us not to use, you know, any version except for the King James, and you couldn't find it, so then we had to discard the teaching.
All right, that's 10.5 minutes.
Hey, great.